This is my 48th year of teaching, and it's still fun, most of the time. But Sunyoung was one of the most extraordinary students. And she really paid attention, and she still listens to me most of the time. Also, I could not be prouder of her for what she has built around her in terms of community, in terms of the museum, in terms of the press, the books, the international connections. And it's going to be up to you and people like you to keep this growing, because this kind of talent, effort, and generosity does not happen very often. So it's reciprocal. It has to come both ways. Okay, pictures. I knew by the time I was 17 that I wanted to be a photographer. I was a visual learner. I did not know I was dyslexic until much later. So in school I had a difficult time, except in classes where I could visually see things, like in biology and in art. And I was very fortunate to go to Rhode Island School of Design and work with Harry Callahan as my first instructor. And I had a very good art education there, and I fully loved photography, and I wasn't very good technically, but the visual, the way the camera and my mind and the world worked together was extremely fulfilling. And then in graduate school, I studied with Aaron Siskin in Chicago. And then I moved to San Francisco, where Imogen Cunningham was a friend and helped me get to know this, the photo community. During that period, my work went through a number of stages, as most young photographers will. I was interested in documentary photography. I was interested in collage. I was interested in photographing the landscape. But during that period, I slowly grew into really favoring a view camera. At that time, I was using a 4x5, you know, with a tripod and a hood. Most people, it's crazy. This makes much more sense. But, and now this. I still like the difficulty. I don't know why. I'm not a musician. I don't have that talent. But if I did play an instrument, it would be the cello. Now, you can imagine getting on an airplane with a cello, traveling around with a cello. It's a pain in the butt. That's the way I feel with my view cameras. Now I use a 4x5, which is much nicer. There's something physical about your instrument. And even though the digital cameras are so good now, there's so many things you can do, but they have too many buttons. Tonight I'm going to show you 4 or 5 bodies of work. Each one pretty much represents a book. For each of those, I'm going to not talk. She's not going to talk either. We're going to play some music. The first body of work is, represents this book, Solos, which was, finally came out in 1979 after 7 years of working with a very unusual 8x10. It was from, it had been in the family, and it was a 1905 wooden 8x10 with a soft focus lens. No shutter, you take off the lens cap. And I used it very, very simply, and the glow and the soft focus you could see on the ground glass. You never know how the picture's gonna come out, but you could see that. Okay, the only other thing I'd like to say is this, I had wanted in the book each picture to be singular. But I learned that when you make a book and when you put pictures one after the other, it makes another meaning, whether you want it to or not. So for the first time I was forced to work with sequencing. And it was very difficult, but I learned a great deal from that. Okay. So let's look at solo. So after working with a soft focus lens for 6 years or so, I started putting a sharp lens on the 8x10 some of the time. And that seemed to be the real next challenge. With the soft focus lens, you can take a very simple something and it looks sort of special. But the same picture with a sharp lens would not be interesting. And I was challenged to see if I could get the same kind of poetic intensity with a sharp lens. Not only did I have the travel bug by now, but I realized that I could not find what I was looking for in most of the American landscape. Shopping centers were not interesting for me. Although some of the American landscape was. So I started traveling to Asia for the first time, to India, to Nepal, Ladakh, eventually Cambodia, Vietnam, and I became more interested in the deeply historic and the sacred places. Not that I was looking for a religious quest, but I think human beings can respond to the construction of the sacred, whether they know anything about the belief or not. So the second book, Odyssey, took 35 years in span to get together. And it was more complicated in terms of sequence and all of that. So, but I would say it's the best representation of my work, the bigger part of my life as a photographer. I didn't tell you about is with the 8x10 work, even with the soft focus work, I was contact printing my images on a wonderful antique paper called printing out paper, which I would expose in my garden. So you have a print frame and you contact the big negative with a piece of paper and you stick it out in the sun. You can check how it's coming, kind of baking. And when it's done, if you haven't left it too long, you take it in, it can stay in a box for a while until you can tone it and fix it with gold chloride and regular fixer and then wash it and stuff. And it turns a really beautiful, we have a print on, we'll bring out a print afterwards. It's a very rich brown color that I'm very fond of. Another thing I didn't mention before, those images of the heavens, you know, that looked like old glass plates, they were old glass plates. I did not make those pictures. I was an artist in residence for a while at the Lick Observatory, which had a beautiful historical archive of astronomical, that's a little bit better. And so I would take my printing out paper to the observatory and make exposures there with some of their plates. The timing isn't one right after another. Sort of overlapping Odyssey coming out. I was hired by a museum in the Midwest who was having a show of Andrew Wyeth's, oh, let's see, Andrew Wyeth's famous picture of Christina's World, okay? And she looks like a young girl here. She was actually 55 and not so pretty. But that was her house, and that is now a historical monument, mainly because of this picture. And so the museum was going to have sketches of Andrew Wyeth's of this place, and thought it would be interesting in the exhibition to have some photographs that made sort of showed the place now. So I got to go there. I normally don't do commercial work because I usually fail at it. So I was nervous about taking the job, but I then told myself, Linda, you know a lot about the history of photography. You have Andrew Wyeth's work. There's a lot of ways that you can play off of other people's work while you're there. Just have fun. So this book came out of it, and Sun Young and Dots Press, I've very thankfully did the book on it, and then I did a larger portfolio set with digital images, and I'll tell you more about digital. And they gave me a key, so I could go at night too. Okay, then digital photography hit. And printing out paper was finished. Everything had to be done through a computer. Too many buttons. But there were some good things, like I can make bigger prints. I can spend more money. I can hire assistants. I can print on silk. And currently I'm printing some work on aluminum. But one good thing, so I started working with a 4x5. Much lighter. One of my favorite places in the world is in northern India. You know, India is kind of shaped like a turnip that goes up and then there's a knob on top. It's up there, past the front range of the Himalayas, right between Pakistan and Tibet. So lots of political issues around the border, but Ladakh is a Buddhist area, very dry, very high, and in the winter, which I haven't been, extremely cold. But unlike Tibet, it has not had a cultural revolution, which is a good thing. So it's a place of my heart. So I keep going back. There's a Buddhist meditation cave that the tourists don't know about. It's a fairly steep hill getting up to it. And it's 12th or 14th century. It's phenomenal. And so I photographed there a number of times. At least one of the pictures in Odyssey is from that place. And there is a painting on the wall in this cave of the Bodhisattva of compassion. I photographed that one time very intensely. Also on that trip, I did a lot of landscapes, mountainsides, rocks. They've got a lot of rocks. They've got a lot of mountains. When I come home, I have my assistant make me small, quick prints, digitally. We scan, I still make negatives, we scan the negatives, make little prints. And I had them laid around in my studio, and I saw one of this painting of this Buddha next to one of the mountainsides. And they talk to each other. We could actually show that afterwards. A small accordion book that I made. The project that is continuing after this, or started here and continues, I'm calling Once the Ocean Floor. Because I think you know that what is the Himalayas was once ocean, and it got pushed up into the tallest mountains in the world. And so I've been photographing those mountains, not so much as landscapes, but as almost a surface. And some of these images I'm printing fairly large on aluminum. And some of these I did just last summer.
Okay, those are much better in person.
I'm going to show you one more short body of work. Two summers ago, I got to go to Italy for a few months. My one goal was to go to Pompeii and photograph the dog, the cast of the dog, that Giorgio Summer photographed in 1870-something. When they excavated Pompeii, you know, Vesuvius, they found strange holes occasionally when they were digging. And they realized that they were molds from people, mainly people, who had died during the ash fall. And their bodies weren't burned up immediately, they died. So they formed a cavity, and they would fill those with plaster and recreate the body. And one of the holes they found was a dog who had been guarding. And I thought it was one of the most moving photographs from the 19th century that I'd ever seen. I wrangled my way into getting permission to go into their archive and so I got permission to photograph these casts and almost just a little bit more. And then my assistant made the backgrounds disappear. So that's the last body I'll show you. And that Sanyang's Dots Museum was the first place to exhibit that last year.